Oregon won the toss. They will start with the football. They've got Charles Nelson, number three in America already this season. An average kickoff return, deep to receive. And he'll bring it out. And he's tripped up, shy of the 20-yard line. So our first opportunity to see one of the most exciting backs in America, Royce Freeman.
In a year in college football where you've got dynamic backs in every single conference, Royce Freeman, don't forget about him. Put him right at the top of the list. He's smooth, never hit hard. He's patient, slow to, and explode through the hole, averaging over 9 yards a carry this season. And he's powerful as well. 225 pounds, already the third leading rusher in Duck history. He sticks around here next season. He'll own every rushing mark in their proud and illustrious history at that position.
And his presence should take a lot of pressure off of the senior transfer, but still, at this level, inexperienced quarterback in Dakota Brukop. Empty backfield. Brukop well protected, and he'll take a shot to the outside, and that should be good for a first down, and it is. Scooped up by Darren Carrington, so that's a good start for Brukop. Accurate throw outside the numbers.
And tremendous protection. If he's going to get that kind of air around him with a four-man rush from Nebraska, it's going to pose big problems for the Cornhuskers.
Three on two at the bottom of your screen. And Brukop on a keeper, finds a lane, and slides, gives himself up, rather than take a hit at the 39-yard line. Freeman on second and five, and there's the power. That's a first down to the 45-yard line.
Empty yards after contact, and he's got it all. And to do what he's done in his career, to pass some guys and to be staring at some more records, you've got to be dynamic all the way around, and he is.
Welcome to one of the great scenes in all of sports, much less college football, for the 350th consecutive game. Memorial Stadium in Lincoln is sold out, but they're watching their defense try and get a stop against one of the best offenses in college football. The Oregon Ducks, a negative play there. That's their first. This the opening drive of the game. Bob Wischusen, Brock Huard, and Allison Williams, one of, Brock, the ranked teams on the road today. That's an underdog. This is a huge challenge for a senior grad school transfer in Dakota Brukop. His first road start in front of 90,000 here in Lincoln. And they buy some time with a flip in the flat. Charles Nelson picks up about two, brings up the first third and long that Oregon will have on this opening drive as Aaron Williams came up to make the stop.
And it's a money down all across college football, but especially in this matchup. I fully expect both offenses to be able to move the ball. Too many advantages athletically. This game will come down to third down conversions.
Nebraska blings the blitz. Brukop over the middle. Incomplete. Threw it behind Charles Nelson. We expect both of these defenses to bend today. Whichever one doesn't break has a big advantage because we're thinking this is going to be a very high-scoring game. Ian Wheeler will try and pin Nebraska inside their 20, if not inside the 10-yard line. Demorne Pearson-L at his own 10. As the Huskers are about to get the ball for the first time. Fair catch at the 16. For the first time, let's check in with our partner, Allison Williams.
Well, guys, the first drive for the Ducks results in a punt, but what a way for Dakota Brukop to get started, get that under his belt. This is by far the largest crowd he has ever played in front of, with 90,000 inside Memorial Stadium. It's about 80 degrees outside, guys, but before kick, I had the chills. It is absolutely electric. I watched Dakota Brukop come out of the tunnel. He took a quick knee in the end zone, bowed his head, then he jumped up, exploded out of that stance, ran by me smiling, yelling. He is trying to feed off the crowd inside of this stadium.
How he handles the pressure today could be the difference in this game. Tommy Armstrong, of course, has been in this cauldron many times before. And he'll start with a handoff to Terrell Newby for about 2 yards. Justin Hollins with the duck stop.
I would expect Oregon to try to play as fast as they always can as you get a good look at the very athletic Hollins there on the edge. And I expect Nebraska to take a little bit of time. Their greatest defense today will be this offense. 8 seniors on it, plenty of experience, and they want to run right at an incredibly inexperienced front seven for Oregon.
Divine Ozigbo, he had a 100-yard game opening day against Fresno State. This time stood up after a gain of a yard, so now a third down and long for Nebraska, and a third down and long for Tommy Armstrong, who already has passed Taylor Martinez's record for most touchdown passes in Cornhusker history, and he could pass him up today for most yards as well.
It's be all about decision-making for Tommy today. About one time a quarter, you just scratch your head, and he's got to hope, the Nebraska faithful hope, that it doesn't result in a turnover, which has happened too often in his career.
Down the sideline, almost hauled in with one hand by Westerkamp. But it will be fourth down. That's a three and out for Nebraska to start. So that will bring out the punt unit, and that brings us back to about as emotional a moment as you could imagine for Husker Nation. Crying on the sideline was Tommy Armstrong when on opening day, the first time the punt unit was out there, Sam Foltz, who was killed in an auto accident on July 23rd, along with former Michigan State punter Mike Sadler, was memorialized with an intentional delay of game penalty that was very classily declined, obviously, by Fresno State. So the freshman Caleb Lightborn, with a very good kick here, was never expecting to be the replacement for Sam Foltz. And there was not a dry eye in Memorial Stadium that day, and Foltz memorialized everywhere, and you could see in the background there his jersey.
Thing that kicker Matt Wogan suggested to his head coach, and Coach Riley told me before the game, he told Coach Helfrich just how much that meant to his guys.
Royce Freeman for about a half yard, and that gets you a little choked up when you see how the opposition understands the impact that that has had on the team that they're playing, and that is a classy move. Play action for Prukop to the sideline, and that's a completion, but all over. The coverage was Dedrick Young.
Well, I'll tell you what you're seeing from Nebraska is very base defense. Mark Banker is familiar. Defensive coordinator 14 times matched wits with Oregon. And Oregon's always felt like this defensive staff plays them a little different than everybody else. And Nebraska's been aggressive this season. They've been incredibly multiple. But right now, doing their best to keep everything in front of them and those safeties deep.
Blitz off the edge on third down. Prukop on a keeper. Gets out of the pocket. Gets to the sideline, and he's got a first down. We wondered about his composure in this atmosphere, and he could have rushed a throw, he could have made a bad decision, but pulls it down and picks up a third and nine.
That's your third down. The first third down, I thought he was hesitant. He was in between on his throw, and that time, you take a big breath. You know, that's a play right on your shoulders that you make to keep the play, keep the drive alive.
Royce Freeman breaks a tackle and muscles his way for about 8 yards on first down. Is it just that he plays at 10:30 at night sometimes on the West Coast that Royce Freeman is not a name that just trips off the tongue when
yes.
You talk about Heisman candidates?
Yes, and even best running backs in college football, yes.
There he is again. And barrels his way for an Oregon first down to the 39-yard line.
And a little bit like spread quarterbacks, as you see him hobbling just a little bit. Keep an eye on that. Spread quarterbacks have put up tons of numbers in spread systems throwing it. There have been highly productive running backs within this system, but I don't know if there have been many as complete as Royce Freeman.
Tony Brooks James takes his place. First and 10 for Oregon. Prukop has all day. The pocket starts to collapse. He extends the play and dumps it off underneath to Darren Carrington.
This is a Nebraska crew that's going to struggle to rush the passer. Lost a couple of their prominent defensive linemen last year. That's Freeman down on the bench. That is something you've not seen much of in his career. Also incredibly durable, but a hard time getting the quarterback, which is four.
Keeper for Prukop. Slides for a first down. He looks very much at home in this atmosphere so far.
Defensive end here, unfortunately, Ross Desiris, can't have your eyes down. You know what you're going to get. You're going to get a mesh point and a quarterback in Prukop that knows how to handle that zone read. It's not the effort you need on the edge.
Another keeper for Prukop. Out of bounds at the 20-yard line. A gain of six on first down, so Oregon in the red zone.
There's some quarterbacks that need to get hit to feel like they can get into a game. There's other quarterbacks that want a completion. In their first 15, they're very active, scripting it with their coach for lots of completions. Dakota's a kid that I think wants to get a sweat on. He wants to get running because the pass is going to come off of this run action.
Play action. He's looking for the end zone for Carrington, and it's broken up at the goal line. That's the senior, Ethan Gary, a captain for the second consecutive year, saving a touchdown for that Husker defense.
Can't play better than this. Nathan's eyes are in the backfield the entire time, and he's got to feel where the wide receiver is and high point it to force a critical third down here in the red zone. Third downs in red zone are going to define the outcome this afternoon in Lincoln.
And both teams, Brock, you would expect, would have not much of a problem moving the ball between the 20s. It's when you get inside the 20-yard line that could determine this game. Turning the corner and getting down the sideline. Brooks James hurdles a man. Is he in? Yes! Inside the pylon. That's a Ducks touchdown. A third down run gets the job done, and we'll make sure that he stayed in bounds all the way down the sideline.
And he does. And I showed you on tape yesterday, Bob. Ross Desiris, 88, the D-end on one side. And that time it was A.J. Natter. You're going to have to play a lot of people on the D-line. Those two ends, when they are in the game, it is problematic. They're not terribly athletic. They're big. They're bulky. They're strong. And with an Oregon running back group that they will tell you is the fastest as a group they've ever had, they're going to try to take advantage and exploit that size and not speed on the end and at that defensive end position in particular for Nebraska.
A trick play looking for 2 points to start the game. And they've got it. Charles Nelson. As they spread out the point after group, and Aiden Schneider, the kicker, a little shovel pass to Nelson, the speedster. And Mark Helfrich dips into his bag of tricks early and steals an extra point. 8-0 Oregon. As Oregon with a trick play 2-point conversion to add to the Tony Brooks James touchdown. And this is going to come out to the 25-yard line for the Husker offense. Our first opportunity to check in with Cassidy Hubbard. Wow, it looked like that might be the team, Michigan, Brock, that could be in the catbird seat after today if some of those top teams go down. We've already seen one top team in Florida State embarrassed on the road at Louisville. Tommy Armstrong uses the stiff arm. He's not going anywhere. Dragged down behind the line by Justin Hollins. That's the good news for the Ducks. The bad news, what we see on the sideline, and that is Royce Freeman with an ice pack on his right shin. And Brock, that does not look like a player that's coming back in anytime soon.
No, I'm not a doctor, but typically when the ice comes out, your afternoon is done. And that's a significant blow. The good news for the Ducks, they feel like they've got three other backs that they will share the carries with and they're comfortable with, but their workhorse looks like he's on ice for the rest of the afternoon.
Armstrong on a quarterback keeper to the 31-yard line, a manageable third down and four. And you blink your eyes and there are expectations on Carson Wentz as the Eagles and their rookie take on Jay Cutler and the Bears at Soldier Field. Week two of Monday Night Football, 8:15 Eastern on ESPN. Our coverage begins with Monday Night Countdown, served by Applebee's at 6. Also streaming live on Watch ESPN.
And I'm sure somewhere Carson watched North Dakota State beat Iowa today, one of those other upsets from this morning.
It was a three and out on the first drive for Nebraska, third and four here. Armstrong, long throw to the sideline, but not nearly coming out of his break. In time was Alonzo Moore. So it is another three and out for the Huskers.
That's just a rush. And Mike Riley gets everything he wants here, those third downs, and the conversion rate is going to be critical when you're playing Oregon and their offense. You cannot go three and out, three and out. Plenty of time, lots of space in the pocket, just throws that comeback route way too early.
Caleb Lightbourne's first punt was his best so far this season at 46 yards, but he'll also be doing what he can to keep it away from Charles Nelson, who is electric if he gets an opportunity. And this one is a mile high, and Nelson will let it hop. Takes a Nebraska roll to the 23. Oregon defense, they are making a ton of noise as the Big Red have their defensive group out there against the Ducks after giving up a touchdown on that last drive. Here's Taj Griffin. And it is a speedy stable of running backs for Oregon, and they need to be, as their depth is now going to be tested, as Royce Freeman is still over on the bench with an ice pack on his right shin, showing no signs of coming back into this game. Counter handoff. This time behind the line. Nowhere to go for Griffin. Brought down by Michael Rose-Ivy.
And that's going to be advantage Nebraska. Any slow developing play, screens, this is just counter action there, quarterback and running back. And you allow Newby and Rose-Ivy and Dedrick Young and these linebackers to come downhill, they'll finish. It's getting out on the edge where the perimeter speed for the Ducks has been simply too much in their two opening drives.
Third down and nine. Prukop, he's going to go down. Ross DeZuris was the red jersey that got there, but that was because there were a lot of red jerseys in pursuit.
Eyes and feet, the two critical areas in this system. Dakota Prukop, his eyes immediately go right to the rush. That's where Helfrich wants him to just try to find a way to get the ball out. Immediately he can feel Akinmolidun beat that edge rush. Doesn't matter. Get the ball out of your hands. Eyes and feet will be a focal point of our conversation today.
DeMornay Pearsonell, fair catch at the 45-yard line, and he's a terrific punt returner. So the crowd always wants to see him bring one back. As we take a look at today's player spotlight, brought to you by the U.S. Navy, and it's Devin Allen of Oregon. Speaking of speed, not only a world-class wide receiver for the Oregon Ducks, but a world-class 110-meter hurdler. Not only got to the Olympics, but made it to the finals in Rio. And last week, this was his celebration of a touchdown against Virginia. Busted out the hurdles in the end zone. Quite the same height, though, that he got in Rio.
A little more of a restriction with the football pads on. Watch for the shot play here. Area of the field, you love to take it.
Instead, just a straight quarterback keeper. Tommy Armstrong picks up about two. Great field position to start on this drive for Nebraska. And obviously, we're going to see, I'm sure, plenty of Devin Allen as the afternoon goes on. The skill position depth that this Oregon program has is amazing. There's speed everywhere.
It's national. And they're from all over the country. And they know you're going to get a chance to play basketball and grass and use that athleticism and speed and really see it come to life in their system.
Armstrong, easy pitch and catch for a first down. Out of bounds is Stanley Morgan. And let's go down to Allison.
I've been keeping an eye on Royce Freeman. He's been sitting here very calm, very quiet. Now, they had that ice on his right shin. The athletic trainer came over and removed it. He grabbed it and put it back on. And when they were looking at his shin and removed that ice, that was the first time I really saw him wince in pain. And you can say now they are applying it back to that shin. I will continue to keep an eye on him as Oregon does not release any injury information.
All right, Allison, thanks very much. We'll take a look at that play in a moment where he was injured, as right into the heart of the defense goes Terrell Newby. And you really have to slow this down to see the right leg of Royce Freeman make contact with the left knee right there. It doesn't seem to be the type of collision that, and with just his slow trot off the field, would obviously make you think, wow, he's really banged up, but he has not gotten up off the trainer's table since that happened.
No, we've seen the ice, and my hunch is probably going to see an x-ray next. No, it's not on the calf, it's on the shin, and whatever it is, bad news for that Oregon running game.
Play action, a rollout for Armstrong. To the sideline, incomplete. Reaching back was DeMornay Pearsonell, and that brings up a third down now. Third and seven for Nebraska.
That's one of those decisions. And Tommy's come a long way in a year and a half in this system. A lot more of a pro-style system with Danny Langsdorf, Mike Riley. But accuracy in the short throws in decision-making, and that time, as good an athlete as Tommy is, he's got to run. There's no need to try to force that ball into coverage down the field. It's a balancing act between the creativity of his athleticism and that pro-style decision-making required in this system.
Only a three-man rush on third down, so Armstrong has time. A bullet outside the numbers for a first down. Stanley Morgan walled off Arian Springs and was able to make the catch.
We saw the comeback earlier where he just tried to throw it with anticipation. And this time he waits, a little pivot route. Good job by Stanley to come back to the ball. Stanley's going to get a lot more run today. Brandon Riley, the senior wide receiver, the fastest Cornhusker, out with a hamstring injury. That means a lot more of Morgan, and even the walk-on Brian Reimer's 83 as well. But that was a dart, and a necessary dart on third down.
Sixth play of the drive. Terrell Newby is inside the 25 to about the 22-yard line, a gain of 3.5. Austin Malawata. This is a tackle for Oregon.
This is better. And Brady Hoke was brought here, defensive coordinator, for a couple reasons. Number one, he's got a defensive line background, and he wants that group to come to life. The best defenses in college football, look around, ladies and gentlemen. They start, as usual, on a defensive line and getting everybody lined up in the right spot. And so far, this run defense on these first three drives, a lot better than they've been the first two games.
Look at end zone, and this is going to float out of bounds, as does Morgan. He was bumped, and there's the flag. Ugo Amadi was running with Stanley Morgan, and looks like he's going to draw the penalty.
And the coaching point to Ugo is, you don't need to do it. The wide receiver ran himself out of bounds. He never climbed back on top. There was going to be no room to fit that completion in. I think that's what this conversation is.
There is no foul in the play. The ball was ruled to be uncatchable. Third down.
And that's a judgment call. I can live with it. I understand it. Because I put that as much on Stanley Morgan as I do anybody else. He has got to find a way to climb back on top of Amadi. And Amadi right there, unnecessary to even have the contact to draw the penalty flag. But once again, sets up one of these critical third downs that we're going to be talking about all day, Bob.
Nebraska with their first third down conversion of the game on this drive. They went three and out on their first two possessions. And you wonder how often you can settle for three in this game and stay in this game.
And how good does Brady feel about his coverage, Brady Hoke? See if he decides to bring some pressure. Good indicator.
Here comes the blitz. Armstrong beats it to Westerkamp. Breaks a tackle. That's a Husker touchdown. Down there. Will teams maybe go for it in this game on fourth down a couple of times where they might not other weeks?
And I think Brady Hoke knows he's going to give up a lot of stats. He didn't come to Oregon to be D coordinator to be number one in defense. You're going to give up a lot of yards. But what he was hoping and what he said to us this week is red zone touchdowns. That has to be an immense change in factor. We're terrible last year. And this year, worse. That's now the ninth touchdown in 10 red zone trips. That's not good enough for the Ducks defense.
Returnable kick from the six for Charles Nelson. Finally stood up at the 25-yard line. Back to Cassidy Hubbard. That Wolverine defense is going to be in the spotlight today because it's a Colorado team that can move the football. We'll keep our eyes on that game. Back to the offense. Dakota Prukop with a handoff. Tony Brooks-James tiptoes down the sideline with a flag out.
Holding. Number six of the offense. 10-yard penalty. First down will be repeated.
The eyes tell the story. Watch Dakota Prukop feel the pressure right away. In his eyes, he's looking right at the D end, and he flushes. Tommy Armstrong, years of experience in the system. Same pressure, same look is coming right down the barrel at him, and his eyes never leave his receiver. And that coverage behind, that's the difference between a sack, a conversion, and a touchdown there for Nebraska.
And the penalty makes it first and 15. Prukop starts to feel a little pressure, stumbles forward and goes down. That'll be a sack. That's a loss of a couple. Ross Durzis again was all over Dakota Prukop.
I know you're a scratch golfer with Susan.
Oh, yeah.
But you know when you're in between, it's the worst place to be. And Dakota can't be in between. So much of the conversation this week and watching the tape and talking to the coaches, just make the decision. Just take the layup. Just get the ball out of your hands. Don't overthink it.
Well, there's a layup as he sets up a wide receiver screen to Charles Nelson, and that is instantaneously diagnosed by Nathan Gary. So now it's third down and at least 11, if not 12, for Oregon.
And this place was loud earlier. Listen to it come to life. Listen to the fourth voice in our broadcast and the factor they love to play here.
Four-man rush. Prukop with flags down. That might be a false start. I think they blew this play dead. You just couldn't hear the whistle.
Before the snap, false start. Number seven of the offense. Five-yard penalty. Third down.
Is that just pure crowd noise on third down causing that false start?
Yes, sir.
You say that like you've experienced this before. Oh, you have. That's right.
I flushed that memory behind.
No, you didn't. We brought it all back. We have plenty of pictures to show you. Might be the final play of the quarter. Third down and 17. Dakota Prukop gets out of the pocket. Needs to get to the 35. Gets a block. Stays in bounds. Short. Weaved his way out about 3 yards shy of the first down. So the Nebraska defense holds. It will be a punt for Oregon to start the second quarter. Ducks with a one-point lead. A wild atmosphere here in Lincoln.
Champion and 11-time All-American from Lincoln, Heather Brick.
Midway through the first quarter, Demorne Pearson-L was second-team All-American when healthy back in 2014 as a punt returner, but forced into another fair catch here. Lost the football! It's on the deck! A scramble for it! He was looking right up into the sun, and before that ball was kicked, was trying to shield his eyes from the sun. And Nebraska avoids disaster as one of his teammates, somewhere at the bottom of the pile, has the ball. Sigh of relief for DeBorne Pearson-L.
In pregame, you saw guys shielding their eyes like those outfielders, and that sun is blaring right down on them. And you would think someone with the experience in this building would have handled it a little bit better, but just shows you what everyone's nerves. On a Saturday in front of a national television, and it's going to be a highly contested game throughout. Even a veteran can see one slip through his fingers.
Armstrong on first down. Underneath to his tight end, Seathan Carter. Now, why does Nebraska have the football? Why do they force a punt?
You know, I love new language, and this is going to be cover two, and you're going to see it right away here. And Dakota will as well. You see the linebacker flying out, and I love learning new language like take the layup. And that's what they talk about at Oregon. Take the layup. And the layup's to the bottom of your screen, a wide open Tony Brooks James right there to just dump it off, to have an awareness of the coverage, of where people are, and make sure you take your check down when you've got it.
Devine Azigbo breaks a tackle. A yard shy of the first down. It'll be third down and one. Well, you would think a fifth-year quarterback, graduate transfer, a player that's seen a ton of defenses, even at a lower level in Dakota Prukop, but it's just different when you're playing at Montana State. And now you come to play in front of 90,000 on the road for a ranked team.
And because Vernon Adams could do it does not mean that Dakota's going to be as natural in that transition.
Flags down. False start. And that's a big one. Third down and one becomes third down and six.
False start. 42 of the offense. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
Can't blame that one on crowd noise.
Now, these are great fans in that way, aren't they? As loud as you're going to find when the opponent has the ball, and as quiet as you're going to find 90,000 to be, even though it's dotted with a little green and gold in certain parts of the stadium, some Oregon faithful making their way. Some of the best fans in college football right in this building, and you've heard it for decades.
First Nebraska penalty. But changes the look here. Spread. As Armstrong slings one right to the first down marker to Seathan Carter. Depends on the spot. Looks like he's a half yard short. Reggie Daniels closed quickly and made the stop. It'll be fourth down.
And it was a senior that jumped. The fullback there playing tight end, Trey Foster, and it's a senior there. And Seathan Carter, that's a half yard short. Mike Riley didn't come to Nebraska to punt. He didn't come to Nebraska to play Oregon again for the 15th time and punt, did he? Not with eight seniors in this moment like this.
Will they snap the football? They will. Armstrong, quarterback sneak, the push, and it looks like he's got it.
That's eight seniors that start on your offense, including the quarterback, most of your skill people, couple up front. And Tommy Armstrong most comfortable there. He is a runner that's developed into a passer in his 5 years in Lincoln. And I love that call. I love what Mike Riley just told his team, what he just told his offense. And when you play someone as prolific as the Ducks on the other side, and he's known it in 14 matchups going 4-10, you got an opportunity with inches to go to get a first down, stay on the field, you're going to take it.
Ozigbo into the heart of that Duck defense, stood up and driven back. Johnny Reagan got there first, and that was going to be my question. What does that tell you about the way, strategically, that the Husker coaching staff is approaching this game? That you need to extend possessions and maybe take some chances because you're not going to play a game in the low 20s and beat Oregon.
Nope. And your experience and your playmakers, and even a year ago in the struggles of a 6-7 season, you were still good offensively. The strength of your team is your offense.
Screen, and it's there, right down the tunnel to Alonzo Moore. First down and then some.
1 1/4. Danny Langsdorf, Mike Riley, as good a screen game as anybody in college football. And you're going to get 1 1/4 from a variety of players. You don't know where it's going to come. And look at the big boys out in front. Led by Dylan Hunter, the setter right there. They love it. The only problem is there's nobody to block. And at 300 pounds, you don't want to just block turf. You'd love to go hit somebody. But a well-executed, well-timed screen call, no surprise from Riley and Langsdorf. Been doing it for decades.
Alonzo Moore has a sore shoulder. He may have been grabbing it after that hit. Here's a jet sweep. Man, this one, DeMornay Pearsonell diagnosed by the Duck defensive front, tripped up behind the line. Jonah Moy brings him down for a loss of 6 all the way back to the 44.
And some moving pieces for Oregon here defensively today. Jalen Jelks, question mark. Jonah Moy is starting ahead of Troy Dye, missed some practice time this week. So an inexperienced group that returned just one starter in their front seven. More moving pieces today. They're playing hard. You can't play the fly sweep, something they practice against all the time, any better than Jonah just did.
Armstrong, swing pass, right flat. Ozigbo weaving his way to the 36. Brings up third down and a long 7, maybe 8. Arian Springs made the tackle, and it will be third down and 8.
4-down territory.
Well, I think that last quarterback sneak on first on fourth down earlier in this drive, as we talked about, that's a window into how they're approaching this game.
And this is key here. You just don't go backwards. You can continue to maintain four down territory. If you gain positive yards, you just can't find a negative play here. And if you're Oregon, you're doing your best to create it.
Blitz coming. Seaton Carter through his hands and through the hands of Justin Hollins, the defensive end that had sagged off the line. So now it's fourth down, but fourth and 8, not fourth and 1 in that gray area. This is a long field goal attempt if you try it. And it looks like, once again, they're going to leave their offense on the field for fourth and 8. And a little late coming out of the huddle as well. Play clock down to 10. Armstrong wants to get his team set. Play clock down to 5. Four-man rush. Armstrong over the middle. Broken up. Oregon gets the fourth down stop. And Arian Springs gets the pass defensed. He was all over Alonzo Moore.
You hear it said, those DBs and the good ones that find a way to get off the field, they run the route for the wide receiver. It's exactly what Springs' homework showed him. He undercuts the in-cut, and he gets the Ducks off the field defensively.
Selling out Memorial Stadium in Lincoln for the 350th consecutive time. And they just made that announcement while we were away. And now the crowd urging on that Husker defense once again after the turnover on downs. Great field position for Oregon. Prukop, there's a layup. Exactly what you were talking about, Brock. Take the simplest play that's there. Charles Nelson picks up 8.
And Mark Baker, defensive coordinator for Nebraska, is keeping it simple. You see this in the early down situations. He does not want to give up the catastrophic play, which was such a big part of the woes of their defense last year. And there's going to be throws just like that for Oregon and Prukop to take.
And I, Benoit. Good run. Picks up 3. Again, the reason you're seeing Taj Griffin and I, Benoit, Tony Brooks-James alternating at tailback is Royce Freeman hurt his right shin in the opening quarter. And he's still over on the bench with a towel around his head. Has not been able to get up off the bench. Looks like he's probably done for the day. To midfield goes Benoit for a gain of 2. It'll be second down and 8.
And that's a significant loss because of what he brings to a defense. They know. They know the exploits and everything that he's done. They prepared for him all week long. It's going to be a little bit more of a fear factor because of just his game-changing ability. But Oregon also knows they've got 3 guys they believe in behind him.
Play action for Prukop. Flips one left wide open. And stepping out of bounds is Nelson. Easily picking up another Ducks first down.
Feet and eyes. They're going to tell the story for Dakota today. Feet and eyes. There's no substitute for experience. Not ideal. Big Kevin Maurice is right in his face, but enough arm talent to make an accurate throw. And when you got the playmakers that the Ducks have and the space that they like to play in, there will be ample opportunities.
This time to give and trying to turn the corner and getting bumped out of bounds is Benoit. Freedom knocking Molodun. Stretched it out, brought him out at the 26-yard line.
6-yard gain for the Ducks. Second and four.
Tony Brooks James back in the game at tailback. Down the seam, open and unable to hook up with Darren Carrington was Prukop. Just a little too much air under the football, or it's a walk-in Ducks touchdown.
And that's a miss, and he's not missed those the opening couple weeks. Six touchdowns, no interceptions. Pretty good protection against the pressure there. The perfect call. The lengthy Carrington at 6'2", and you can see it right there. He knows it. At the right call at the right time, just not the lack of execution. Unable to finish.
From what should have been six to third down and four. Play clock at five.
Doesn't get it off.
Flags down. It'll be delay of game.
Well, Helfrich tried to run on the field and looks like they gave him the timeout. Former quarterback head coach could feel that coming.
Under the expiration of the play clock, Oregon has called their first timeout of the half.
An official did throw a flag, but Mark Helfrich given the timeout. Back in a moment. Not a cloud in the sky, and a big third down. Midway through the second quarter, Bob Wischus and Brock Ewart, Allison Williams, and 90,414 of our closest friends. Big play here after the timeout, avoiding the delay of game. Prukop runs it on the give. Benoit stood up. Now it will be fourth down, and Brock, with a less experienced quarterback, do you kick a field goal here, or do you think Mark Helfrich will start to approach this game much the same way that Mike Riley did? Looks like he's leaving his offense out there to go for it as well.
Yeah, on the road, I take the points, and I got a kicker that's made 92% in his career. To go up four here early, I take the points.
Oregon is 0-for-2 on fourth down so far this season, going for it on fourth and 3.5. Prukop over the middle, in stride, not only a first down, but it's first and goal at the 2. Dwayne Stanford on the in cut, all the way down to the 2-yard line.
But Oregon rarely plays it by the book. I love what Mike Riley said. Nobody knows Oregon better than Mike Riley. He said, describe Oregon to me in one word. Pretty simple, bold. Bold. They're bold in their uniform, they're bold in their scheme, and they're bold in their decision-making just like that on fourth down. Don't take the points. Instead, put yourself in prime real estate for a touchdown.
Timeout called defensively by Nebraska from their bench. First and goal in just a moment for the Ducks. After the Nebraska timeout defensively. Tony Brooks James, he's got one touchdown. And looking for number two, stopped at about the yard and a half line. Marcus Newby, the first Husker there. It'll be second down and goal.
And he hits it. He's only 180 pounds, but when you run 4-3 and you run as hard as you can, there's an awful lot of force slamming between the tackles.
Now it's Prukop. He goes submarine style to the 1-yard line, and he gets stopped as well. Now it's third down and goal.
This is going to test your redshirt freshmen, three of them on this offensive line. They've been good. I'm watching tape this week. They're a lot better than I anticipated with the inexperience up front. Last two, manhood tests. Can you push them off the spot? Nebraska responds. And yet again, a critical third down, about the fifth in this first half.
Farrell Brown in motion. Trying to go wide and turn the corner is Brooks James at the pylon. Stays in bounds. That's a touchdown for Oregon. The second for Tony Brooks James off the bench in place of Royce Freeman.
Well, his buddy helped in front, Jake Hansen, the redshirt freshman center. You could see it. He peels out in front. This is an athletic crew. And these three redshirt freshmen are going to grow into tremendous players. Throckmorton, the right tackle. Mew, the left guard. Hansen, the center. Tons of experience they're gaining this season. Can't do it better than that. Get Brooks James out on the edge. Now the fourth touchdown, and all of them of that variety getting outside.
And they bluff to go for the point after again and snap it to Charles Nelson. He wants to throw. Flips it in the end zone. Incomplete. So going for two the second time comes up short. And all in all, Oregon ends up with a seven-point lead. That is some scene. When those players touch that horseshoe, they put it up on the big board, and you get a chance to watch the Huskers take the field here in front of 90,000 plus at Memorial Stadium. Ball off the tee, so we will tee it up once again for Aiden Schneider. After Brock, somewhat curious decision for Oregon to go for another two-point conversion after they already had one in the bank.
Well, I'll just land on that bold. I love that word yesterday from Coach Riley as Nebraska staff. You know what you're going to get from Oregon. They're going to be bold in their decision-making. Think about the upside much more than they ever think about the downside.
Okay, Matt Wogan, the kickoff specialist, showing you why through the back of the end zone. And Brock, back to your eyes, a big fourth down conversion.
Well, this was a bold decision in a little football. You got single safety, and that's going to dictate coverage. And then as a quarterback, I'm looking for man zone indicators. The face mask there tells me man to man. So does the motion. As the motion runs away, I know I got man coverage, and this is the game. Here's Nathan Gary, the country's leading interceptor amongst active players. He's free, and he's reading everything. He just doesn't undercut it. You can see the frustration he has. That's the difference. Fourth and four, you're bold, you make the decision, you see man coverage, Dakota's has to beat the coverage, and Nathan Gary is going to be kicking himself. He saw the whole thing happen in front of him, and he couldn't pull the trigger to make the play.
Play action for Tommy Armstrong. That ball deflected and falls harmlessly incomplete off the back of David Neville, his right tackle. It'll be second down and 10. That was an incompletion, but the last possession, just a hair ahead of Taylor Martinez, moved Tommy Armstrong into first place all time in passing yards in Nebraska history.
Here come four new Ducks on the field, and what Tommy's seeing and sensing and feeling is a lot better effort from Oregon defensively than what he watched on tape the last 2 weeks. These guys in the front especially playing hard.
The pile moves for a gain of 6.5, 7 yards, maybe even 8 for Terrell Newby. Brings up third down and 2.
These are the opportunities you cannot press if you're the quarterback. You just have to know. Third and 3, third and 1 earlier, jump off sides, don't convert a third down. Third and 3, with the rate with which Oregon plays their offense, you have got to keep your defense off the field and move the sticks.
Pump fake, Armstrong able to clear room with that ball fake. He got the eyes moving at that second level of the Oregon defense. The seas parted, and he picks up a first down.
He could see that motion man. They didn't run with him. They just bump over. He knows he's got zone coverage. There's no pressure. And there's the patience. The patience of a fifth-year senior to allow that zone coverage to drop. And the athleticism to find the lane to convert.
Nebraska now 3 for 7 on third down. That was a big one. Armstrong looking downfield. Seathan Carter, the tight end. Boxes out the defender at the 35. Tyree Robinson held on to bring him down, but that's a chunk play and a first down.
It's a game of inches. Tyree sees this happening. They know these play action passes have been in this system forever. Tyree can sense that over route coming. He just can't stop himself. And Seathan Carter's making himself some money. In an NFL that seeks tight ends from the collegiate level and do not have nearly the supply, this guy stays on the field for 13 games. He's going to elevate up the draft charts. Difference maker.
Play action. dropping the football is Stanley Morgan. And Saturday Night Football presented by Wells Fargo at 8 Eastern tonight on ABC as soon as we're done. It's a Pac-12 matchup between the Trojans and Mr. Everything, Christian McCaffrey, as he is certainly in the midst of the Heisman race. The Cardinal and the Trojans coming up tonight. We check in with Allison.
Spoke with Holly Rowe, who will be covering that game. She said USC's quarterback starter will be Max Brown. He's earned the job. But Coach Helton said that you will see some of Sam Darnold.
Getting loose and breaking tackles is Newby down to the 15-yard line. That had a little Christian McCaffrey wiggle to it as Nebraska's back in the red zone.
And that had a little lethargy for that front that I was just praising for their effort. You can see they don't take blocks on. They're not downhill. They're catching everything. That's what the Ducks did the first 2 weeks with some of their run defense. The first time that Nebraska really creases them and puts themselves inside that red zone where, again, you could see the numbers. 8-9 coming in, already allowed one earlier. Not good enough. This defense will give up yards, but they've got to find a way to be stout down here in the red zone.
Trey Bryant, Mikhail Wilbon in the backfield now. This time it's the true freshman. Trey Bryant lost the football at the 12-yard line. There's a scramble for it. And it stays with Nebraska. And it looks like the true freshman, Trey Bryant, got back his own fumble. And he will head right back to Mike Riley's sideline. Devine Ozigbo now into the left of Armstrong in the shotgun. A backwards pass. That's a live ball. Mikhail Wilbon has to get after it. Can't pick it up. Instead, it's with the Ducks. Arian Springs down the sideline. What a huge play. All the way out to midfield on the turnover. And the Ducks in business with a 7-point lead.
There's no doubter. I mean, oftentimes this is down the line, maybe half a yard. There's no doubt. This is 2.5 yards behind the line of scrimmage. And you just got to find a way, if you will, Bonnie, just jump on that. There is no need necessary here to try to play it off the bounce. You fall on it as best you can. And wonderful awareness once again from an Oregon defense whose strength is their speed on the perimeter. We saw Springs earlier with a fourth down stop. An incompletion, undercutting that in-cut, and that time the awareness to pick it up and go. How's that for a stop in the red zone? And those are game changers. That's not holding to a field goal. That's taking the ball away. Really changing the dynamic in this building.
I'm spinning it 35 yards back in the other direction as well. So now all the time in the world for an Oregon team that can score running the two-minute drill as well as any offense in America. And they'll spread things out. No one home for Taj Griffin. Touchdown! One play after the turnover.
And it was Jake Hansen earlier, the offensive center that got out in front. He does it again. These kids are athletic up front. They signed six of them in the 2015 recruiting class. Bunch of former high school basketball players that have added strength, that have added weight. And Hansen does a beautiful job of getting his eyes up. And you create any seam for these 4-3-40 guys, they're gone. Gone against this defense.
And they are not changing their philosophy as they set Charles Nelson up for another two-point conversion attempt. He'll just try and straight run it, and he will come up short. So it's a 13-point lead for Oregon. A flag down, though, in the offensive backfield.
The extra point is no good. After the conclusion of the play, dead ball. Unnecessary roughness, number 79 of the offense. This 15-yard penalty will be enforced on the succeeding kickoff.
So that could give Nebraska some field position, but Griffin extends the Oregon lead. Six.
Well, Nebraska at their worst. Negative 12 in the turnover margin a season ago. A big reason why they were 6-7, and Oregon at their best, taking advantage. And capitalizing on game-changing speed that very few in college football can match. The Matt Lubick, their offensive coordinator, told us this is the fastest running back room they've ever had. A 4-by-1 team of the running backs would beat the very fast 4-by-1 of the wide receivers. That's saying something.
Vital possession here for the Huskers before halftime, and they'll start it on the ground. And a strong run of 5.5 yards by Newby as we go back to Cassidy. All right, Cassidy, thanks very much. As Ethan Carter picks up a first down. And Brock, to start the game, Oregon won the toss, took the football. So Nebraska will start the third quarter with the ball. They have a chance to string together back-to-back possessions. Here comes the blitz. Armstrong, strong throw. That's good for about 8 yards to Alonzo Moore. So this is a very important possession, you would think, before halftime for the Huskers.
And it sure is. And maybe some of that mentality, as you try to understand it, is not only just very much in the fabric of the aggressive DNA they have, that bold DNA, it's also understanding your defense is going to give up some points. They're going to give up some yards, and when you have an opportunity to score on your side offensively, they'll do it.
Long throw to the far side of the field, and again, good coverage. Arian Springs all over Stanley Morgan. Now it's third down and 2.
A double move is going to be coming his way. That's now 3 different plays that you have seen him make very aggressively. But he is asking for a hitch and go, for a slant and go, for an in cut and go. It's that fearless, reckless line that not only quarterbacks walk, but cornerbacks do as well. And Springs is sitting, squatting, trying again to make a game-changing defensive play as they had in the previous series.
Westerkamp broken up. That time it was Tyree Robinson. 4th down and 2. Still with 1:14 on the clock and 2 timeouts for Oregon. Plenty of time for the Ducks to put more points on the board if you don't go for it. And they are going to kick it back to Oregon. Not going for it. Nebraska on their side of the 50.
And Oregon playing safe defensively, keeping much of their defensive unit smart on the field as well.
Caleb Lightbourne will kick it to Charles Nelson. Down the sideline, Nelson tells his teammates, get away from the football. And it's downed at the 17. Time now for our Aflac trivia question. Devin Allen, only the 4th active college football player to compete for the United States track and field team in the Summer Olympics. Can you name the other 3? And all 3 names that you should recognize.
All playing in the NFL?
1 playing in the NFL right now.
Well, that's enough. Don't give any more secrets.
As the New York Jets were made painfully aware of on Thursday night early in the game. Is that enough of a hint, at least as to one of those names?
And this kid's got a shot. He's not a track guy that just, you know, happens to play football. He's a football guy that also happens to have world-class track speed. Tough kid.
Quarterback draw. Prukop picks up what he can. Out to the 24, a gain of 7. Stops the clock with 1 minute to go. And, of course, Oregon with those 2 timeouts.
Listen to how quiet this place is. That 4th voice was full throat through much of the first quarter. It's trying to make some noise, but right now on their heels as Oregon took advantage on the previous possession of the turnover into 7 quick points.
Incomplete. Sets up 3rd down. Josh Banderas with good coverage for Nebraska. Crowd might not stay quiet for long. This is an important 3rd down with under a minute to go before halftime.
And if you're bold, you've got a chance to take a shot here. I think play action pass, Nebraska's going to, I believe, do everything they can to get numbers up to stop the run. They've hit shots the previous 2 weeks. If you're bold and daring, play action shot may be in order.
Instead of handoff. And it's not there. Taj Griffin secures the football, is brought down, and Mike Riley will call a timeout. So Nebraska down to 1 timeout remaining, 50 seconds on the clock, and the Huskers will get the football back. Now, we didn't give you much time to think about it.
Aflac.
The answer to our Aflac trivia question. Devin Allen, only the fourth active college football player to compete for the U.S. in the Summer Olympics in track and field. Will it Bob Hayes, James Jett, and Marquise Goodwin for the Buffalo Bills had a long touchdown the other night. When he was at Texas, he made it to the Olympics. And Devin Allen makes it four.
College recruiters will tell you the same thing NFL draft guys tell you. There's simply no substitute for speed. And then when you've got toughness, and you want to put on tape to measure a receiver's toughness, watch them block. All of these Ducks will get after it, and they will block. What an incredible story. Spends the offseason training, coming off of a significant ACL injury as well, to work all the way back. And not just to go to Rio and watch, but to go to Rio and nearly medal.
Will Pearsonell get a chance at a return this time? He fields it. That'll be kick catch interference, and he breaks a tackle. DeMorne Pearsonell, he's loose. All the way down to the 18-yard line. You are world class if you can fight off kick catch interference and return it into the red zone.
Kick catch interference. Number six of the kicking team. His penalty is declined. First down, Nebraska.
That's the big safety corner, Tyree Robinson. Excuse me, Nelson coming down, trying to make the tackle. He can't. And instead, Pearsonell, who has been so dynamic in his career, is just that. And if you've said it once, you've said it six times already in 3 weeks, Bob. The factor that this phase of the game always plays. In big games, equally matched teams, the special teams phase, so critical.
Critical now for Tommy Armstrong. 34 seconds and one timeout to manage the clock in the field well. Over the middle, wide open. Stanley Morgan fights for a first down, and that will stop the clock. Khalil Oliver made the stop, but that allows Nebraska to preserve their timeout. And now Armstrong, with the clock stopped, rushes up.
Smart.
And gives up the down.
Smart.
You like it?
I do.
I don't.
The clock's going to run. You're going to take 2, 3, 4 seconds in that moment right there. No matter how quick you get up, guys got to shift, get into formations. You got to get in the play. Still got three downs to score here, a timeout. I like that clock.
And with the timeout, I would have thought that you could have used the down there. Now you may have limited yourself to just two downs before kicking a field goal,
Morgan,
depending
their second time out of the half.
Upon what happens. And I can certainly understand why you want to get your offense regrouped if you can. But at the same time, these plays down in the red zone are so critical. I would have thought that you could have gotten your offense up there, gotten set, and maybe been ready to utilize all your downs inside the 10-yard line rather than having to give one up.
Well, the proof will be in the pudding. We'll see in the next two plays if they take advantage. And I just, as quickly as you can operate, I think those 3, 4, 5 seconds, and especially you have worked in the red zone. Maybe if this is the other areas of the field and you can get to an automatic play, but you know red zone tendency, what they do, what you want to do against it. More often than not, it's motions, it's formations, it shifts. So I like trying to take advantage and get everybody on the right page.
Well, you've been down there as well. I haven't. So obviously you know how frantic those elements of play can get, trying to get everyone lined up and the amount of time it can take.
And regardless of whether you like it or not, they need seven here. Against an Oregon crew that is starting to find their rhythm offensively and whose speed outmatches your speed defensively, you cannot settle with your Nebraska for threes.
So after the Oregon timeout, Armstrong looking for the back pylon, and no chance for Westerkamp. So now it's third down. Now by spiking it, you may have given yourself only one more opportunity to get that touchdown before halftime. And there's still 22 seconds on the clock, and they have the timeout.
I don't know why. That's about the third pass we've seen from Tommy where he feels rush coming. And he's had tremendous protection. The front four for Oregon has not got close to him, has not hit him in many passing situations. He's going to have a little more patience down here when I know the clock speeds up.
Armstrong looking end zone again. That should have been intercepted. And a flag comes out. Arian Springs again aggressively jumped the route.
Pass interference, number 8 of the defense. It's foul occurred in the end zone. By rule, the ball would be placed at the 2-yard line, first down.
Well, they call the penalty on Reggie Daniels. And boy, does this change things, as now the ball is at the 2-yard line, 18 seconds. Nebraska still has a timeout, so the entire playbook is at their disposal. And look how late the Ducks are running players onto the field. They can't even get set on defense. Now a flag comes out. And it looks like this may be called against the Huskers.
False start, number 11 of the offense, 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
So Seathan Carter called for a first start. That will put the ball back at the 7. So it's still first down now after the pass interference penalty gave the Huskers a fresh set of downs. Armstrong, fade route again. Incomplete. Flag out. Just put the ball back at the 2-yard line again. Hugo Amadi was in coverage on Alonzo Moore. It looks like he'll be called for pass interference.
In just 3 seconds off the clock, and this is a no-brainer. I looked 3 times at the previous third down. I didn't see any pass interference on Reggie Daniels or Arian Springs on the previous third down. This is a no-brainer and a no-doubter. And if you're beat,
pass interference,
well.
Number 14 of the defense. The foul occurred in the end zone. By rule, the ball would be placed at the 2-yard line. First down.
And he went off the jump. And that's Alonzo Moore. That's the redshirt senior. And once you get on that edge and you're a DB and you feel that receiver getting to that back pylon, you know where the throw is coming. It's a smart play to tackle instead of giving up the touchdown.
Play action. Armstrong out on the edge. He'll tuck it under. Goes out of bounds. 9 seconds to go in the half. Johnny Reagan ran him out. Now again, you can still run the football here if you're Nebraska because you have that timeout. But having said that, Brock, if this play takes too much time off the clock, you might leave yourself with only one more snap regardless of the down.
Yep.
So what do you call if that's the case?
I get to my very best play. And if that is a run play right here, get after it. And if I got numbers and one-on-one, which I do outside, you've got to hit and win your one-on-one opportunities.
Armstrong, fade route, Wester Kent leaping, he's got it! Touchdown, Nebraska!
One-on-one across the board, and you're going to trust your number one, one of the most prolific in the history of this program, to win, and you give him a route combination to do just that.
A flag thrown well after the touchdown was scored. Might be 12 men on the field for Oregon.
And oftentimes, Bob, I know I'm much too conventional for today's college football, but after I get that first two-point conversion, as the Ducks did, I feel like I'm playing with house money. I got an extra point. I stole an extra point. And if I take 2 PATs with a automatic kicker, I'm sitting here right now at 21, 22 points.
Substitution infraction on the defense. 12 players in formation. Half the distance to the goal. Extra point play.
And I know that's not their mentality, but that would be mine. I love the aggressiveness, and Wester Kent delivers as he's done in his career. But you have 8-7-7, go up 22-14 going into halftime, and instead now you know Nebraska gets a conversion here. If they end up just taking the one, which they will do, they're telling themselves at halftime in a half where they were at times outplayed, Certainly the Oregon speed came to life. You get a touchdown, you're going to take the lead to begin the second half for no reason other than your decision making to be aggressively going for two time and time and time again.
So Nebraska will start the third quarter with the football, and a touchdown would give them the lead. Let's go back and take a look.
I apologize to any Miami Dolphin fans, but this is the exact play that Russell Wilson hits Doug Baldwin in the final 30 seconds in a pro style system. What's a pro style system? You just get your guys one-on-one situations and give them an opportunity. You know you got one-on-one, and this is a pretty simple throw. Just throw it right to that back pylon. Tommy Armstrong gets it up in time, just as Russell did to Doug Baldwin a week ago. Run a play that you'll see at the next level. And Mike Riley in the years to come will continue to find the Derek Andersons and Sean Mannions and the guys that love to sling it and try to find a way to get to the league. Tommy likes it.
And had a little something to say as well, as Jordan Westerkamp with his third touchdown catch this season and the 16th of his career. That's also the 136th career reception for Jordan Westerkamp, who extends his streak of at least one reception in every game to 29 games, and also ties him with Terrence Nunn for fourth place in Nebraska history, most career receptions. So when you're a senior and you catch as many balls as Westerkamp has and does, just keeps on climbing all of these different categories in the record books.
Now three and out comes to bite Oregon. It's the ball back with a minute to go, up 20-7, just one first down. You won't give Nebraska the ball back. Instead, it's three and out, the big punt return. And then once again, a wild swing and a motion, which we find in college football often.
Well, a chance for Charles Nelson to get a return, but he'll just head out of bounds to end the half. So Nebraska will start the third quarter with the ball. And a big momentum switch before the end of the first half. It's only a six-point lead for Oregon. We'll join Stan Verrett, Mac Brown, Mark May, the halftime report after these messages. His absence, when you're without your best player, obviously you wonder if that's really going to impact, but they've got 20 points on the board in the lead.
Yeah, 166 yards rushing in that first half. I would say not a significant impact. You know, a chance to run for over 300 yards in this building. Not a lot of folks do that, and Oregon will continue to do what they do no matter who is under center or who's playing tailback.
And it will be a touchback to start the second half for Nebraska as we take a look at our Pacific Life game summary. And the big injury, of course, early to Royce Freeman.
And when he was in there, marched right down the field for a touchdown. Not a freakish hit. The ice on the shin, a pretty good indicator that he was going to be done for the day, but no shortage of speed in that running back room. Three plays, run plays, over 20-plus yards. The first one there, the first touchdown to Brooks James, that one to Taj Griffin. And the more they get out on the perimeter, away from the line of scrimmage, away from those linebackers, I got a hunch we'll see a few more of those big plays in the second half, Bob.
So a chance for Nebraska to string together back-to-back touchdowns. End the first half on a touchdown. Start the second half with the football and start it with a bull rush by Divine Ozigbo for close to 9 yards as we check in with Allison.
I talked to Mike Riley at the half, and he said getting that big punt return and setting up that touchdown was huge for his team's confidence going into the half. They had some missed opportunities earlier in the game, so to be able to finish out that drive with the touchdown was huge for them. Defensively, as far as dealing with Oregon's athletes' individual speed and then the overall speed of their offense, he thought they did a pretty good job. Just needed to clean up a few things here in the second half.
Well, their offense has a second down and one to begin the second half. It's a play caller's dream, and they'll go conservative and move the chains with Ozigbo. And without Royce Freeman, we saw still the blinding speed at times of that Oregon offense. Brock, so building off of what Allison talked to Mike Riley about, what adjustments would you have to make if you're Nebraska defensive?
Well, you just do your best to eliminate the big play. They were one of the worst in all of college football last year in plays of 20-plus yards. And when Oregon has hit those big plays, they've scored touchdowns. And when they haven't, well, they've gotten a three and out. They've found a way to get off the field. Eliminating those will be critical. And on the other side, Oregon's going to have to hit them without Royce Freeman down in and down out.
Ozigbo again, carrying tacklers for a Husker first down across the 50. Here is today's right combination brought to you by State Farm. And that right combination has been through the air. Tommy Armstrong to Jordan Westerkamp.
Now the first one, Jordan did a wonderful job in zone coverage of creating space for his quarterback. In the second, he took advantage of a safety. Reggie Daniels in a one-on-one situation with all that real estate on a perfectly thrown pass. Had no chance, and you see the body control from Westerkamp to finish.
Two deep safeties as Oregon is kind of daring Nebraska to run with a light run box, and they'll run right at it and pick up three. Austin Malawata was able to bring down Ozigbo. Second down and seven.
And this is some of the fear if you're an Oregon football fan, is the second halves have not been very kind to you. Season ago, this season, the inability to really finish off your opponents, your inability to stop the run for 60 minutes, especially in the second quarter with a light front seven, has been problematic.
Quarterback draw. There goes Tommy Armstrong. A first down for Nebraska inside the 30. He's the only active FBS quarterback with 7,000 yards passing and 1,000 yards rushing. He is a dual threat player, and he picks up a first down there.
He got a little help there from his running back, Newbie. We pointed out on the other side, the offensive center, Jake Hansen, has thrown a couple beautiful blocks for the Ducks. That time in pass protection, Newbie picks up the free runner. Plenty of space for Armstrong to do damage.
And now we've got another running back injury to talk about. That's Terrell Newbie. Last season, he spent most of the year playing on a sore ankle that he sprained early in the year. Still picked up close to 800 yards rushing. And he and Ozigbo are a nice 1-2 punch, but now it is Ozigbo back in the game with Newbie on the sideline.
Keep an eye right here. Go-to guy, difference maker in the red zone.
Ozigbo turns the corner. Almost got free. To the 22. Gain of six.
I told you earlier about Seathan Carter. I love him in the passing game. I love him even more as a run blocker. It's hard to find tight ends in the collegiate game to do this. To be able to turn the hips of that defensive end and contain, and he doesn't quit. From just outside Louisiana, New Orleans, Louisiana, loves to block. He loves to finish. Shows up on tape, shows up in a big time way, and to have that asset is so beneficial in today's college football.
Armstrong to throw. Look at end zone, climbing the ladder, making the catch, and reaching it out for the goal line is Brian Reimers, and he's got a touchdown. The walk-on sophomore ties the game.
Reimers in for the injured Brandon Riley. He's doing his best. Brandon Riley move was down and walked through yesterday, and Brandon said, you just wait. I bet you Brian's going to make a play. The former walk-on redshirt sophomore does. And that's Brendan Schooler, the true freshman safety. He had coverage over the top. His job to try to collision that ball out, and he does his best at 6'2", 190 to climb the ladder. And the kid they're very high on, Schooler, the ability to play corner, the ability to play safety, a true freshman that came into camp late. And good to see him up as he used every ounce that he has to try to separate ball from receiver. Just could not quite get it done.
So good to see Schooler off, and talk about off and running to a terrific season. How about Tommy Armstrong? That's his third touchdown pass of the day. So he is up to 60. For his career, adding to his record here at Nebraska. Last year, 22 touchdowns, 16 interceptions, though. Always making that maddening mistake at the wrong moment. Well, he is off to a much more efficient start this year. Six touchdowns, or rather seven touchdowns against only one interception through the first three games. And the point after gives Nebraska the lead. If Oregon had kicked extra points, this game would be tied. Be an app and watch ESPN. We'll see Christian McCaffrey tonight. And now we have Oregon down a point. One successful two-point conversion in the first half, followed by two unsuccessful two-point conversion attempts. That's why they're down by one. And getting stood up at about the 22-yard line is Charles Nelson. Mark Helfrich was asked by Allison Williams going in at halftime about specifically that strategy.
Why have you decided to go for 2 points every time you've scored?
Well, we like the looks we have. We just need to execute them. We had one time where a guy wasn't paying attention, and again, just execution.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you.
They get the looks. They get the numbers. I mean, this is what they do. I don't want to be apologetic or make excuses for them or say it's necessarily wrong. This is what they live by. They're daring. And you can't question the level of success they have had through the years. One of the top programs in all of college football having that methodology over the last decade.
Play action for Pruka. Wants the big play. And that floats way over the head of Darren Carrington. It'll be second down and 10.
And for the first time, taking the field with a deficit. And he's got to remind himself, does Dakota, continue to get my playmakers involved. Coach Elfrich also said at halftime, a message he's repeated over the first couple weeks, do not think, react in this fast-paced system and get the ball out of your hands.
Prukop well protected. Low throw. Is it scooped up? The officials say no. Have to take another look, but Devin Allen, did he hold it and get his arms underneath the football, or does this skip? Certainly bounced. Good call by the officials. Third down and 10. Blitz coming. Prukop flushed out of the pocket. Dragged down at the 25. It's a three and out for Oregon. Freedom Akinmolidun was there to bring down Dakota Prukop. Offensive line problems, Allison Williams, could be popping up throughout the second half for Oregon.
Yeah, their junior left tackle, Tyrell Crosby, headed into the locker room at the end of the half on crutches, his left leg in a boot. So his backup is Brady Aiello. He is a freshman. That means four of the five guys up front for Oregon are all freshmen.
We'll see how that lack of experience plays out in front of 90,000-plus throughout the second half. Here's Snell, calls for a fair catch at the 38. Good field position for Nebraska. And the Huskers have the lead early in the third.
Those are three minus plays on the great sheet. First one, he should have scrambled. He was ready to go. I mean, you got to relish these moments. College football fan, you're a college football player. This is the kind of cathedral you want to play in. That's a poor series. Three opportunities on first, second, and third for Dakota. He's got to turn it around, and he's got to hope his defense brings a little more force and impact on their tackling than the previous possession as well.
Zigbo does well just to get back to the line of scrimmage as we check in with Allison.
Well, a little bit more on Dakota Prukop. Offensive coordinator Matt Lubick told me before the game, he's one of those guys that plays his best in the biggest moments. It's one of the things they liked about him watching him at Montana State. He practices hard, but he's able to put it into a different gear on game day.
It's interesting that that's the way that they would look at it. As Matt Lubick, I certainly don't doubt how well he knows Dakota Prukop, but how would he know? I mean, the biggest moments that he has had as a quarterback probably don't compare to what he is now facing for the rest of this afternoon. Tommy Armstrong lofts one down the sideline. Incomplete. Crowd looking for a flag, and it comes out late. Arian Springs was step for step with Alonzo Moore, but maybe that little bump at the end is what drew the penalty marker.
And you can see it. He's got his hands behind his back now, but he knows. These side judges, back officials.
Pass interference. Number one of the defense. 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
Hey, they have indicators. Just like a quarterback has clear looks of coverage, they have indicators, and you armbar like that and you push right in front of that back judge, you're going to draw the penalty. And once again, the throw is taking him out of bounds. There's no need. You've got to trust your positioning. You've got to trust that you are watching that boundary come quicker and quicker, that you've done your job, push that receiver to the sidelines. No need for that extra push, 15 free yards.
Seventh Oregon penalty gives Nebraska a first down. Quick hitter on the outside. It is on time for Alonzo Moore. Very close to a first down as we go back to Cassidy Hubbard. With some really compelling afternoon games going on right now, and this was supposed to be just the appetizer to what we'll see tonight. So many great games tonight as well, as Armstrong set up second down and one. Hand off to Ozigbo, reversing field, weaving his way and reaches for what might be a first down. It looks like he has it. If you think about that Michigan-Colorado game, obviously Alabama and Ole Miss in a close one. We've got a terrific game here, and Brock, the games tonight, I mean, across the board, there are games in week three where the entire college football playoff landscape could change.
Feels like opening weekend. And I'll tell you what else this feels like, a double move. A double move to, against a couple very aggressive corners. They've been waiting on it and sitting on it. Now would be the time.
Oregon shows blitz. Instead, they'll run it with Ozigbo. He runs hard. Five, maybe six more yards. Nebraska already has as much rushing yardage in the second half as they had the entirety of the first half.
Well, this is exactly what Mike Riley wants. We talked about it going into half. If you found a way to score, you're going to get the ball to begin the second, and you know the entire conversation in that locker room. Drive down and we'll take a lead. And then you get a three and out, and you're going to have an opportunity to possess the ball almost the entirety of this third quarter. Best defense, a great offense.
Slant. It is on time to DeMornay Pearsonell. In front of Arian Springs. That's good for another Nebraska first down to the 20, and a good throw by Armstrong.
And once again, you're getting into that red zone area. We're outside of the lateral that went the other way. Two touchdowns already. A very problematic area for Oregon. This is where you have to take a stand. You can swing a motion by simply getting a stop and forcing the field goal here.
Diving down to the 15-yard line is Ozigbo. Now mark him down. Looks like just shy of the 15, so a gain of four on first down. Drayton Carlberg made the stop for Oregon. Swing pass behind Ozigbo. And is that a backwards pass? No, the officials quickly rule incomplete. So that saves Nebraska some real estate. If that had been ruled a backwards pass, that would have been a loss of about 5 yards. Close, certainly forward. And Brock, how big is this third down now for both sides midway through the third?
And once again, this is where number 11 is such a weapon. You tied in Carter. The Westerkamp with already two touchdowns today.
Oregon may have had too many players on the field. Taking a shot to Seathan Carter is Tommy Armstrong. And Seathan Carter delivered a shot to Memorial Stadium. That might have been a free shot for Nebraska, as Mark Helfrich is claiming that he was not given an opportunity to have his defense substitute. He's saying that the officials should have been standing over the ball and giving his defense the right to substitute because Nebraska substituted.
Substitution infraction on the defense. 12 players in formation. 5 yard penalty. Third down.
Yeah, you can see it right up here. Nebraska's going to sub.
If Nebraska substitutes.
They did, and they did. They subbed right before that, and you do not see the umpire over the ball, allowing Oregon to have the opportunity, and Helfrich wants an explanation.
You should have an official standing over the ball, allowing the defense to make a counter substitution, and instead it's third down and one after the penalty. Quarterback sneak inside the 10, backing his way into a first and goal is Tommy Armstrong. And that changes, Brock, the entire nature of that play. Third down and six to third down and one. The whole world changes in terms
sure
of play
does.
Calling for both sides.
Sure does. And look at Tommy Armstrong, and he's holding the back of his leg right now. The enormous injury to Royce Freeman on the other side, knocked out of this game in the second possession. And keep an eye on that wheel of Armstrong on the QB sneak. And he's in some pain.
Is that a cramp that he's trying to stretch out? First and goal. Zigbo for maybe a yard. Jimmy Swain was there in the middle of the Duck defense to make the stop. Tommy Armstrong has mobility as a big weapon in his holster. So if he's got a bad wheel, do you take him out of the game? Do you call a timeout? He obviously just wants to get plays called and keep things moving.
Yeah, and it looked like he actually got rolled up upon defensive lineman there, Carlberg, for Oregon on that third down sneak. And he's doing his best to gut it out. And you're right, those legs have already been a weapon today.
10th play of the drive, second down and goal. Ozigbo looks for a cutback lane and finds one and finds the end zone. That's a Husker touchdown. The good news for Nebraska, a touchdown. The bad news, their quarterback, if that is a cramp, just crumpled to the turf, and they're trying to work it out as best they can.
Quarterback's best friend is a run game. You're not going to see a better cut. And what you saw from Devon Ozigbo on that play, as Armstrong finds a way and he can hear the faithful. Put the foot in the ground and watch Juwan Williams, the safety, right at the top. In order to play team defense, you've got to have your gap responsibility. He shoots the gap, he loses contain. And Ozigbo north and south, that's a big boy. 230-pound, true sophomore, played as a freshman a year ago. Getting his legs underneath them as this Nebraska offense has the last three possessions, three touchdowns.
And Nebraska continues to go the conventional route, kicking point afters. And as a result, Devon Ozigbo makes it an 8-point lead for the Huskers. How will Dakota Prukop answer? Point deficit, about to get the football back. It will be a touchback once again. Let's take a look at this week's college football rankings brought to you by Chick-fil-A, and everything has already changed with Florida State getting drubbed earlier today, and top 10 teams in danger, Brock, of going down.
Yeah, and this team is going to move way up. And you think Bobby Petrino enjoyed putting it on Jimbo Fisher today? Has any accident to see 63 points and Lamar Jackson, the best player in college football? Going right now was red hot in an environment kind of like this one today that's rocking. And this is time for you to go to Prukop. This is where Vernon Adams showed up last year. This is where Marcus Mariota showed up. It's your opportunity right now to quiet these fans and get the ball to your playmakers.
Nice quarterback pull for him, Prukop, and he is into the secondary, and he has a first down in the run game. Right now will be his best friend, as he is one of his last five through the air.
Yeah, Matt Lubick, offensive coordinator, said they're always a series ahead. As fast as they play, they script a series ahead. This script, he's got to see a lot of run. A lot of quarterback run, a lot of perimeter run. Previous series of three and out with three passes, not good enough.
Right up the middle goes Taj Griffin.
I like this
O-line. More.
I like this O-line. I don't care that it has four redshirt freshmen. I mean, it's an opportunity of a lifetime for these guys to gain valuable experience, and we've already seen it a number of times. They have been at their best when Jake Hansen is out front. When Cameron Hunt, the only veteran remaining on that guard, they've been getting enough push in their run game. They've got to show commitment to it here when it matters the most.
They get it to the speedster, Devin Allen. He gets stood up. Ran a long way to pick up a half yard. And it will be third down and 2.5. As again, Freedom and Muladun stayed home and helped on the stop. Speed to the outside, Taj Griffin, met by Nebraska. Oregon is now one for their last seven on third down as Joshua Kalu gets the stop. for a loss of a yard, and it will be fourth down. And now what do you do?
Well, Mike Riley, I think you're going to punt, but they're unconventional. Mike Riley said to us yesterday he really likes his corners. And actually, Oregon is going to stay on the field right now.
Let's see. Where's Ian Wheeler? He is still on the sideline.
5 yard penalty results in the first down.
A penalty was just called against Nebraska. We didn't even see the flag.
Set the game clock to read 4:50. 4 minutes, 50 seconds.
And that will give Oregon a first down.
Lined up in the neutral zone, offsides.
At the snap. My apologies, did not see the flag. What a break for Oregon. Keeps the drive alive. And getting bumped out at the 45-yard line with a gain of four is Tony Brooks-James. Nathan Gary came up to make the stop for Nebraska.
Four straight runs. And I love it. Get back to what you do best when the game is at its most important juncture, and what you do best is spreading your run game around.
Trying to turn the same corner is Brooks James. A little late contact and a flag comes out. Brooks James came up a yard shy of the first down, but now a penalty marker after the play was over, and that might be a late hit out of bounds.
After the conclusion of the play, dead ball, unnecessary roughness, number 78 of the offense, 15-yard penalty, it will be third down.
Wow. That's Cameron Hunt, the right guard.
He just headed right on over to the bench as he took a freebie here, totally unnecessary. And this was the right call on that third down. This is the defensive end, and you can see the helmet in particular lined up into that neutral zone. We didn't see the initial penalty flag, but that was the right call on that third down.
So now it's third down and 16 after the penalty. Prukop flushed out of the pocket. Throws to the sideline. How about that? Charles Nelson right at the first down marker. There are flags down, though, in the offensive backfield.
That's going to be a hold.
Holding, number 57 of the offense. 10-yard penalty, third down.
That's going to be the right guard, Doug Brenner, on this one. And a good pressure look here. You see the inside rush. And all he can do is hold on. Ross DeZuris, the senior there, the former walk-on himself. Helmet was in the neutral zone, drew the 5-yard penalty. At that time, the aggressive stunt and pressure gets Oregon on their heels, which is where they have been for the last 15 minutes of play.
Third down and a mile after two huge penalties. Prukop has room to run. Instead, he'll throw right at the first down marker again. It's Charles Nelson. He took a hit, held onto the football, but he'll be marked short. About a yard and a half shy. Now what do you do if you're Oregon? From third and 26 to fourth down and about a yard and a half, and it looks like they'll go for it.
What a big time play from Dakota there. Three-man rush, buys time. Mark Helfrich wants his quarterback to react, not think, and that's the biggest play he's made this game.
Dakota Prukop putting his team in position to have a chance to go for it. They'll hand it and run power football. Picking up the first down and more. Down the sideline is Benoit with a cutback into the open field. How about that? That's a Ducks touchdown. From third and 26, two snaps into the end zone. That's incredible.
That's called resolve. That's called sticking to what you do best. Missed tackle by Banderas. Does Benoit stay in bounds? I think he does. to win as many games as Oregon has over the last 10 years. You have built a winning culture. You never panic. Within their offense, there is so much time. And Mark Helfrich loves to see the response, and they'll continue to be aggressive going for two.
And now they're not even going to bluff about going for two. It's not a trick play where you've got your kicking group out there trying to get some misdirection. They'll just line up with their straight offense to try and tie the game. Prukop back of the end zone. Broken up. Excellent job by Joshua Kalu. So another two-point conversion attempt for Oregon comes up empty. They are now 1-for-4 trying two-point conversions today.
And this area's got to grow this season. Everything you want is here. You just got to throw it earlier and throw it with authority. You can see the throw there from Dakota. Like many, they've just died upon getting to the receiver. But what a response from Oregon, staring third and 26 and making it a game right again.
Third and 26, and two plays later, they get six. Back to Cassidy Hubbard. Alabama has come back. Michigan has come back.
Oregon has come back. They don't get that third and 26. And by the way, if I'm a defensive coordinator, I never, ever call a three-man rush. Not with the amount of speed, and I understand it. You want to give different looks, and you're thinking with a three-man rush, dropping eight, they'll just check it down. Not this system. Not Dakota Prukop, not the speed that they have. Third and 26 enabled and to find a conversion, and yet again, another big play. Been the bugaboo for Nebraska defensively. Too many big explosive plays.
And a touchback again as we take a look at today's good hands play brought to you by Allstate. And it's special teams again, Buck, that make such a big difference. DeMornay Pearsonell with this punt return just before halftime that turned this game around completely.
27 at that point. The kid that's run back three in his career for punt return touchdowns. Either you have that fear or you don't. And we have seen elite punt returners. We've already seen them this season. Ryan Switzer at North Carolina being the best in the country at it. Feel those guys around you, and even through impact there, the illegal contact, able to break the tackle and do what he does best.
Ibana Zigbo. 4 yards on first down. Allison?
Well, guys, the Ducks have given up 2 second-half touchdowns to Nebraska, and this continues a disturbing trend for the Ducks defense. If you go back, their last 3 games, not including today, they have given up 72 second-half points compared to just 13 in the first half. And Mark Helfrich said it's a point of emphasis. They need to learn how to close the door on games. But you have to wonder, does perhaps the Oregon Ducks defense wear down a little bit in games because they are out there so much as a product of their offense?
And you can see we added those extra points as Armstrong picks up a first down with flags thrown. So it's up to 2 touchdowns more, up to 86 second-half points that Oregon has given up.
And behold,
holding. Number 73 of the offense. 10-yard penalty. Second down.
And we have a Pac-12 crew on the field today, and they are wearing commemorative bracelets in honor of one of their own. Their colleague's son, Sam Day. This summer, Sam passed away at 14 after battling Ewing sarcoma. We pass along our condolences to Bob Day and his family. And his brethren is out there sending along symbolic condolences as well. Second down and 15. Armstrong off his back foot, still with the muscle to get it to the 30-yard line. Khalil Oliver was all over Seathan Carter. But Carter picks up 10. It'll be third down and 5.
He's a mismatch. Talked about him, showed him, highlighted him in the run game. And these are the perfect scenarios. How devastating tight ends can be when you have a physical mismatch on safeties, on corners, on linebackers. You see it with Gronk and the best ones at the next level. Such a nightmare for defensive coordinators to find a matchup to defend a big body like Seathan.
And Oregon get a third down stop. Quarterback draw. Armstrong has the first down. Needed 5, got 6. Well, Nebraska's last two touchdown drives, 7 plays to start the second half, 10 plays after that. And that speaks to, I think, why these fourth down opportunities are automatic play calls, especially for Mark Helfrich. It just doesn't seem like his defense right now, Brock, is one that can get a stop consistently enough that he thinks he can settle to play field position, kick field goals. He always has his foot on the gas pedal trying to score 7.
Well, there's two things that he feels. His tacklers in the back end are just grabbing and reaching and absorbing, and there's really little impact at the line of scrimmage with his front four.
Ozigbo up the middle. That's a routine play right now for Nebraska. Right up the middle, changing the line of scrimmage and picking up 5 yards.
I mean, this is a crew, and I showed you yesterday on tape, that has had DeForest Buckner, the Tad Haloti-Ngata back in the day, the Tad Eric Armstead and Deion Jordan, a front four that you have to have. In my opinion, if you're going to be an up-tempo and guys are going to play, then you need a front four that can just make plays. And every single time on first down run here over the last 2.5 quarters, what have you seen? You've seen those bodies push back 2, 3, 4 yards. And 2nd and 5, an offense will stay on schedule all day with that production.
That takes us to the end of the third quarter. Touchdown here, Brock Ewart, and kicks a point after. They would lead by 2 possessions. And that at least solely due to the fact that Oregon continues to go for 2, and they're only 1 for 4. Each team with 338 total yards on offense as we start the fourth quarter. No gain on 2nd down, so 3rd down and 5 coming up. Terrell Newby brought down by T.J. Daniel.
That's the first time in a while we have seen a defensive lineman shed a block and make a play. T.J. Daniel did just that. And against this run game, and if you're going to find a way, Oregon defensively, to get off the field, your guys up front have to be more stout.
Wilbon motions on 3rd down. Up the seam, instead it goes, and it's broken up, but a flag out. Intended for Seathan Carter. Jawan Williams, the safety, looked to be in perfect position right in front of Carter to make that play on the football. And another flag is thrown, seemingly against this Oregon secondary.
Mark Helfrich doesn't like it.
Pass interference. Number 17 in the defense. Spot foul. Automatic first down.
And I think where Mark is frustrated is this is now the 3rd pass interference, and these guys have been all over it. Arion Springs was all over it. But if you reach and you can see, once again, you just reach and you pull and you keep that arm around, and he pulls from that back judge's decision-making. He sees the arm and he pulls himself in front to knock it down. You couldn't draw the penalty. And Mark's frustration is they're well studied. They know what's coming. They're in position. They just have to stop reaching.
Nebraska 1st down on the 11th penalty of the day for Oregon. Play action for Armstrong. Under some pressure, dancing in the pocket. I guess he shaked off the cramp. Cross his body, that's a dangerous throw. Incomplete. As Stanley Morgan juggled it and almost pulled it in. And Armstrong took a wallop as he let go of the football.
How's Danny Maddie like? Linebacker that just threw him to the ground, and you get one of these a quarter. One of these a quarter where I promise you, Danny Legisdorf up in the booth, the offensive coordinator, say no, don't throw it back across your body. And it led to 15 picks a year ago. Nearly a big play there. That's clean. That's Danny Maddenly coming in and delivering a very vicious but clean shot on the sideline on the quarterback.
Play clock down to 5. 2nd down and 10. Play action once again. Trying to set the screen up. And Armstrong gets to the edge. And he'll go out of bounds. And he is ridden out by Tyree Robinson. That's a loss of 3 or 4 yards. And now Armstrong is down again. The first time it was a cramp. This time, not so sure. Here comes Riker Fife. He was warming up while we were away during our last commercial break, but Tommy Armstrong was able to shake off the cramp and get back in the game. But not so here, as he is being dragged on the bench over to the trainer's table, or at least in that vicinity. He might be working on both of his legs.
Yeah, it's the same action they are, Bob. They're working on both the right and the left. Been running for his life here over the last 2 possessions. Riker, fifth-year senior, former walk-on, threw a touchdown pass against Wyoming. This moment should not be too big.
So Riker, Fife, Cold off the bench for third down and 14 in a two-point game. And they'll let him throw. Under some pressure, sidearms one, incomplete. He was buried behind the line by Drayton Carlberg.
That's the response you wanted, as you see Armstrong and the staff and the medical staff, training staff working on him. But that's the response you wanted. If you're Brady Hoke and you came here from Michigan and you came into a long tenured staff and you're trying to get your guys to finish an awful lot better than they did a year ago, and I'm asking for that group up front in the run and the pass game to be a difference, they were on that series.
Lightbourne, the true freshman, angling one down into the right corner. And it's thrown back in the field of play. What will they say? Where is it down? At the 3-yard line. A 48-yard punt, and Oregon starts inside.
Life, which is exactly what you want in front of 90,000 people on a glorious September afternoon here in Lincoln, Nebraska. Oregon's got the guts and the resolve, built around a program with so much success. Third and 26. And they come all the way back and put back-to-back plays and touchdowns together. And right now, this play under review, trying to determine what further review, whether or not the ball carries into the goal line, why this is not just simply batted out of bounds. I don't understand, but at any point, not where the defender or the gunner is, but where the ball is, clearly does not step out of bounds. And does the ball at any point break the plane? And if it does, it's a touchback.
Now, that's one of the big differences between the NFL and college football. And sometimes the way players act on the field, you can see they don't even seem to understand the rule. In the NFL, it has nothing to do with where the football is. It has to do with where the player is. That's why you see players kind of tiptoe on the goal line, reach into the end zone and throw a ball back. In college football, you can be 5 yards into the end zone. It has nothing to do with where you are. It is purely where the football is. That's why they took a look. And here's the
After
call.
After review, the ruling on the preceding play stands. First down at the 2-yard line.
The only way they would have been able to overturn it, again, with indisputable video evidence, would be to have a shot right down the goal line. And any shot on an angle seemed to make it at least with plausible doubt.
And the side judge was right down the goal line making the call, as you see Armstrong not even taking the time to get to the locker room. Typically that IV is done in the locker room, putting the IV there into Armstrong right on the bench.
So now Dakota Prukop starts from his end zone. He'll give it out on the edge to Taj Griffin. And boy, does he have speed. You know, that was eye-opening when you told me that the Oregon coaches said they think, including Royce Freeman, that this is team speed-wise the fastest backfield they've ever had.
Because that's LaMichael and Kenyon Barnum. Michael James.
Well, those are the names that came to mind. Exactly. How are you faster than those guys? But this group has shown speed today. Second down and 5. Blockers out in front. Speed for the quarterback. Dakota Prukop out to the 30-yard line.
That's big Farrell Brown, his tight end. I'll tell you the one thing that Dakota does very naturally. He rides that mesh point incredibly comfortable. Similar system in Montana State, running that zone read, and that was all about holding that mesh point to the point he could get Farrell in front of him and make the big play with his legs.
Griffin again. Heads south, turns north, and he's got 6 more yards.
And what are you seeing? What you see so beautifully here is Nebraska wanting to gain their push in yards between the tackles in the last 3 plays, finding any creative way through motions, through receivers and tight ends coming to help to get the ball out on the edge, the 200-meter, and let them turn the corner and use that explosive speed.
Read option, and Prukop slides for a gain of 2, brings up 3rd down and 3. Oregon has won for their last 8 on 3rd down. Play action. Prukop looks at the rush, uses a stiff arm, dives, and he's got the first down. Ross DeZuris brought him down, but not before a gain of 4 on 3rd and 3.
And Dakota's been at his best improvising, like so many of these Duck quarterbacks through the years when it matters the most.
Kenai Benoit breaks a tackle down the sideline. He's got a step. Out of bounds inside the 15. Nathan Gary saved a touchdown.
And if you're Nebraska, you're pulling your hair out. Mark Banker, defensive coordinator, do everything right at the edge. You turn it back. You keep contained. You don't allow the 200-meter runner to get to the edge. You push him back in. But 3 Nebraska missed tackles, a defense that has been on the field here trying to deal with speed that is just a step faster than they are.
Dropping the football inside the 10-yard line is Darren Carrington. That last run put Benoit up to 100 yards rushing in the game. But that first down play, a miss as Prukop delivered a strike. Harrington couldn't hold on, so it's 2nd down and 10. Tony Brooks-James is the tailback to the right of Prukop. Prukop on a keeper. Shut down at the 15, lost a couple. And there is the senior, Nathan Gary. Started every game the last 2 years, a captain in that secondary. Came up to make the stop, forcing 3rd down. Prukop on the slant, inside the 5, down to the goal line is Carrington. 1st and goal at the 1. From a drop to a huge 3rd down catch. Tony Brooks-James into the end zone for an Oregon touchdown. And the Ducks retake the lead. What a drive. Starting at their own 3.
And Mike Riley says, I've seen that before. I have seen this Oregon offense now the 15th time matching up. And it really doesn't matter who the running back is, who the quarterback is. They just find ways, unique ways, to get their playmakers involved. And Mike Riley was going to learn about Dakota Prukop. So was the guy on the other side, Mark Helfrich. And what you have learned is when the game has gotten tight and he is needed to respond on 3rd downs, when he is needed to respond from the pocket and improvise, and when he's needed to respond to throw on time, and Dakota has done just that.
And they'll line up to go for 2 again. Prukop on a keeper. At the pylon. Short. So it's only a 4-point lead. Adric Young made the stop at the goal line. Prukop, I think, thought that he snuck the ball inside the pylon. The first points allowed in the 4th quarter this season by Nebraska give Oregon the lead. That close to 2 more. It's 3 touchdown passes for Nebraska. But to this point, that's not good enough. As Oregon has retaken the lead, the Ducks answering back. They lead by 4 as the ball falls off the tee. So Matt Wilkin has to re-tee it. Brock Heward and Bob Wischusen upstairs. Allison Williams down on the field. And the atmosphere and the type of game we've had, Brock, have lived up to every expectation that we imagined when you saw these 2 matched up on the schedule.
Yep. And now we're going to see if Mike Riley's Cornhuskers are different than they were a year ago, where they were 1-5 in one possession games and some of the most heartbreaking, gut-wrenching losses.
Trey Bryant, this one returnable. He gets walloped at about the 19-yard line. Well, today ESPN is proud to support college football's celebration. If there is anything but a celebration going on the field as players have to be separated. And a flag has been thrown, but we are proud to support college football's celebration of educators across the country through the Extra Yard for Teachers initiative created by the College Football Playoff Foundation. And we'd like to give a shout out to Mike Riley, who was a teacher back at Linfield College back in his early coaching days, about 40 miles outside of Portland. And we'd like all of you out there to give a shout out to teachers that have made a difference in your life as well.
Football coach, JV baseball coach, taught four classes at Linfield, did Mike Riley. And
personal foul, grasping the face mask. Number 19 of the kicking team, 15-yard penalty. First down.
That's a big change of field position. Another penalty called on Oregon. They have hurt themselves badly. Well, that's concerned today.
That's now 11. And Mark Helfrich's teams have shown a lot more discipline over the years. But have averaged 10 penalties a game, nearly 100 yards in the first two contests. And a number of them of the big play variety. Pass interference, holding, grabbing, and that time reaching for a face mask.
And Tommy Armstrong shaking off the cramps. He is back in the game at quarterback. And he'll run it on first down. Now, you told me earlier that Oregon is a team that thinks a possession ahead. I'm surprised that they continue to go for two and maybe not think a score ahead. Because now if Nebraska scores a touchdown, and they've scored four today, Nebraska would be up by three, which means a field goal would only tie for Oregon if it came to that. If they had kicked a point after that last touchdown, they would be able to kick a field goal possibly to win the game if it comes down to a final possession. We'll see how it plays out. Second down and nine. Armstrong on a slant, incomplete. Intended for Alonzo Moore. Flag down, thrown late on the near side of the field.
There is a flag on the play. Arius Springs on the coverage.
An eligible receiver downfield, number 77 of the offense. The penalty is declined. Third down.
So they decline the penalty. Quickly back to Cassidy.
Third and nine from the Nebraska 35.
So Alabama with a terrific comeback. We have seen the comeback already by Oregon prior to a Nebraska comeback. Third down and nine here. Armstrong to the sideline, off the fingertips of Stanley Morgan.
Armstrong passes incomplete.
So Oregon's defense gets the stop.
Number eight, Stanley Morgan.
And here comes the punt group for the Huskers.
That's my least favorite play calling of this entire game. Tommy Armstrong, who's hobbled, and you're going to run a QB sweep into the boundary. Into the boundary. You're going to continue to try to throw a slant route against corners that have been hyper-aggressive. And then third and nine, just few options. And you're, once again, you're throwing right into coverage. Not a very productive series in three and out for Nebraska.
So here's Caleb Lightborn to punt. And this time gets away an outstanding kick. To the 7-yard line, it's Carrington. Brought down inside the 15. That is a field position changing punt of 58 yards from Caleb Lightborn. Oregon with the football and a 4-point lead. In Stanford. And it seems like many matchups today have playoff implications. It's also available streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. Starting from about the 12-yard line, Dakota Prukop only picks up a yard, brought down by Freedom Akinmolodun again. He has been active today, a bunch of tackles for Akinmolodun. Taj Griffin is the back to the left of Prukop on second down and nine. He takes the handoff, tries to use speed to get wide, finds a cutback lane, but not much there. The back door shut down. And again, if maybe a yard. Kyron Williams in on the stop. Third down and eight.
Back-to-back snaps where your safeties. Gary and Williams incredibly active in the run game. They've been patient all day, but pulled the trigger on those last two snaps in a third and long where Prukop has been so good the last quarter and a half.
Actually marked down on the 13, so third down and nine. Huskers rush four. Prukop swings it left. Reaching back to make the catch is Griffin. Can't get to the sticks. At least 3-yard shot.
That was all Marcus Newby right there. He's bluffing inside. He's trying to change the picture for Prukop. And he hustles his tail. You're going to play these kind of spread systems with as much speed, you have to have incredible pursuit on your defense. Time Newby does and makes the tackle in the open field to force a critical three and out.
Right at the end of the first half, arguably the game-changing play this afternoon was made by DeMornay Pearsonell. He is set to return this kick at about the Nebraska 45. And this will drive him back to the 34. Great coverage by Oregon. A flag down.
By Wheeler. No return by DeMornay Pearsonell. There is a flag on the play.
And that's Devin Allen, who's also down for Oregon.
After the conclusion of the play, personal foul, unnecessary roughness. Number 13 of the kicking team, 15 yards from the end of the play, first down.
So Allen gets called for a personal foul and is injured in the same sequence. Let's take a look and see what happened.
Correction, the foul was number 17 of the receiving team. 15-yard penalty.
It was actually number 13 of the receiving team, which makes a lot more sense. We're wondering how Devin Allen, and obviously that was what the Oregon sideline was wondering as well, how he could be guilty of a personal foul while he was laying on the turf. And so now they have corrected the call. It is a Nebraska penalty. So now Tommy Armstrong will go back to work with a four-point deficit midway through the fourth quarter. We'll see how the last 7.5 minutes play out, Brock. Keeping in mind, if Oregon had simply kicked extra points after each of their scores, right now they would have a 7-point lead instead of a 4-point lead. Ozigbo with a cutback. And 8 yards, maybe 9 yards on first down as we check in with Allison.
There was a lot of emotion for the Oregon defense before they took the field. Johnny Reagan very vocal, saying they want to run the ball on us. They're not running the ball on us. And Brady Hope trying to kind of light a fire under his defense, telling him it's time to go out there, play hard, do your job and what you have to finish this thing out.
His defense has gotten some stops here in the second half. And they get another one on this drive. Ozigbo breaks a tackle. First down, Nebraska. Tyree Robinson tripped him up, but he's out across the 35-yard line.
And that's Rex Manu. That's the big defensive tackle right there. When they have gotten stops, it has been their people up front who have shed blocks, who have stood their ground, who have been difference makers. And when it's been 5 yards a pop for Mike Riley, or in that occasion 7 or 8 yards, it is your inability to stop that initial push. And that time, Manu, a critical missed tackle.
Right up the middle, breaking tackles again. Into the secondary goes Ozigbo. He's got 9 more. And you start to think about how big a game this is for Mike Riley. 4-10 all time against Oregon. Obviously, most of that with games that had major implications for Oregon State, including 2 games back in 2008 and 2009, where had Oregon State won, they would have gone to the Rose Bowl.
Yep.
And lost both. And we have another injury. This time, it's Jimmy Swain down on one knee, and he is slow to get up for Oregon.
Yeah, he felt the brunt, 230 pounds, coming right at him because no momentum was stopped. Yet another crease in that run game. You can see the difference so clearly. Oregon wants to play this game outside the hash marks, and Nebraska wants to do everything in their power to play it between the tackles. And that time, Swain, he took the brunt of the downhill run game.
These Nebraska fans have sold out this building 350 games in a row. And there is still a passion amongst this fan base that is the holdover from being a national championship contender every single year. And that has not been the case for the better part of the last 2 decades. A fumbled snap. The motion man, with flags everywhere, was hit by the snap. That was Stanley Morgan. Oregon thinks they've got the football.
And that's a false start.
And instead, it's just going to cost Nebraska
five. Before the snap, false start, offensive line. 5 yard penalty, second down.
So that is avoiding disaster for the Huskers. When Tom Osborne was the coach for 25 years, 21 of those 25 years, Nebraska played in a bowl game that we would now refer to as a New Year's Six bowl game. They've only played in three since. How big would this be for Mike Riley to get a win over his old nemesis in year two of his tenure and start off 3-0? Tommy Armstrong gets outside. Turns the corner. First down and more. Flag down.
Holding, number 82 of the offense, 10-yard penalty from the spot, second down.
That's Alonzo Moore, the redshirt senior receiver. He can feel Tommy Armstrong. Both these receivers and receiving crews like to block. He's at the very top. So nearly a face mask as well, blocking the back. I mean, both of these teams, Bob, the tremendous effort, but so much reaching and grabbing, just not trusting your fundamentals and your techniques. So often happens as the environment gets bigger, the game gets faster, you're not trusting your trusty fundamentals.
It was a net gain on that play of a couple of yards, even after the penalty. Ozigbo has a first down to about the 47-yard line.
This is where you have to really start to manage this game. Tommy Armstrong, this is not just take 5 minutes and milk every last second. You still need to have tempo. But they would love nothing more than 4 yards, 5 yards, 6 yards. Be methodical, continue to run right at the underbelly of that defense.
Ozigbo caught behind the line. Knifing through was Rex Manu. A big tackle by the sophomore from Hawaii. And that's a loss of 3 yards, second and 13.
Right in the middle, he crosses the face of Dylan Hunter at the center. He may have missed the previous tackle. And the previous set of downs did not miss that time. And I have said this now for 20 minutes of game action. When is the double move going to come? As aggressive as these corners have played, and as aggressive as you know their mindset is going to be to stop the run, when is the double move going to hit them?
Only one deep safety here. Second and 13, and Oregon shows blitz. They bring five. Armstrong quickly pulls it down to the 48-yard line. So now it'll be third down and about nine. Now Nebraska has all three timeouts. Still a lot of time on the clock, over 4 minutes. But would this be four down territory? Would they be able to put their defense back out there on the field if they fail to pick up this third and nine?
I think you do. And I think you actually trust your punter, who has been one of the game changers of this game. Pinning the Ducks back and being at his very best when they needed him the most.
Armstrong tries to beat the blitz, floats it to his tight end, and Sethan Carter can't haul it in. Reggie Daniels delivered the blow, and the hit was clean, in spite of the fact that Carter is shaken up. And now a huge decision for Mike Riley. Fourth down and nine. And if they go for it on fourth down, they will be going for it without arguably their best pass-catching weapon in this situation, as Sethan Carter has to come off the field for at least a play.
You can see Armstrong having a difficult time with all the cramping and planting his feet and driving that ball. You have a single safety. That ball has to be driven right into your tight end. You expose him to that kind of contact, and Reggie Daniels did what Brendan Schooler could not do earlier. The freshman safety could not separate wide receiver from football on the touchdown pass. And that time, the center field safety Daniels did just that. But the legs, the cramping, the amount of energy that Tommy Armstrong has expended, you would have loved to have seen him plant his foot and drive that ball between the one and the one of Sethan Carter.
And now Sethan Carter walks off, and the Nebraska offense is not walking off with him. They are out there in the huddle. It looks like they'll go for it on fourth down and nine. They are 1-for-2 on fourth down today. So here is that question. Do you not trust your defense? Do you try and punt it deep with your three timeouts? and trust your defense to go get a stop. Well, Mike Riley is basically saying he feels like his offense has to continue this drive. That's going to give them the best chance. What do you think, Brock?
I love the definitive nature. There's no hesitation. I would punt.
Armstrong on fourth down, looking at a four-man rush. Fires one over the middle, and it is a strike to Westerkamp. A fourth down conversion for the Huskers. Keeps the drive alive in front of Tyree Robinson.
But Mike Riley's been consistent. He was aggressive in the first half, going for it on fourth down. Just enough protection for Tommy Armstrong, and unlike the last one where he's backing up, he loves it. He's faced these Ducks too many times. He's lost too many, the last seven against them. He did not want to put the ball back in their hands, wanted to trust the veteran leadership of his offense.
Armstrong on a keeper. To the 34-yard line for a gain of four. Tonight, after Texas and Cal finish up, it is Sports Center at night. That's tonight on ESPN, streaming live on the ESPN app. And watch ESPN with Lisa Kearney and John Anderson. Nebraska continues to huddle up, continues to go relatively deep into the play clock, almost playing this possession as if it is their last. Quarterback draw. Armstrong into the secondary. Armstrong's got a step. Touchdown! Nebraska leads by three.
Tommy Armstrong, an IV on the bench, a senior that's been through the ups and the downs, but right now has got his team on the brink of maybe his biggest victory ever.
Touchdown run, putting Nebraska on top.
The ultimate team game still comes down so often to one-on-one battles. Look at Devine Osigbo against Johnny Reagan. Reagan, who was barking at the bench, and we are going to stop the run. They are not going to run on us. Well, that time Osigbo wins his one-on-one battle and allows Armstrong to do what that kid does best.
Keeper for Dakota Prukup. Out to the 28-yard line. So now you've got the senior transfer quarterback in an atmosphere unlike he has ever been in before. No Royce Freeman, no Devin Allen.
Never heard the noise in my headsets like I'm hearing right now.
Outside, wide open, Charles Nelson. He is a speedster, and he has an extra gear all the way out to midfield. A good throw outside the numbers from Prukup.
Terrific throw. And you move the chains, and look what happens with your tempo. It is that first down that is so hypercritical with tempo teams. And now Nebraska having a tough time even getting lined up.
Slant, bobbled. Charles Nelson, he's got another. There is Adam Schneider. And Aiden Schneider has not attempted a kick of any kind today. Prukup lowers his shoulders and picks up the first down. And only another 3 or 4 yards or so would move Oregon into what they believe is Snyder's field goal range.
If there was any doubt if this moment would be too big for Dakota Prukop, the transfer from Montana State, he's proven to you in the second half it is not.
Prukop on a keeper, turns the corner. Flag down. He's got a first down if the play stands.
Holding. Number 85 of the offense, 10 yard penalty. On the spot of the foul. Second down. Correction, first down.
Told you earlier, those indicators the back judges and side judges look for are the arms out, are you reaching outside the frame, do you turn the defender? I don't know, Bob. In a moment like this, I'm letting the players dictate. I don't see a brutal hold there. I see a DB that gets turned, that loses contain, and I see every indicator to a referee to throw that flag, but what a critical penalty on Farrell Brown.
13 penalties for 126 yards now for the Ducks. First and 20. Prukop. That ball's tipped and falls incomplete, intended for Darren Carrington. Chris Jones got a hand in. It'll be second down and 20 from midfield.
A team that has played 82 straight games with a touchdown pass. 82 consecutive games with a touchdown pass, does not have one on the board. And a quarterback who has yet to turn the ball over this entire season. Can't afford one now in the final 64 seconds.
They don't need a first down to get into field goal range. Four-man rush. Prukop escapes the pocket, directing traffic. Heaves a deep one. He's got a man. Jump ball, and it's broken up. Tyron Williams got in front of Charles Nelson at the last moment. But Nelson was behind the defense. And Prukop on the run just couldn't reach him.
What an incredible game. Incredible moments we're seeing here down the stretch. Just underthrown. Williams just enough speed to distract the incredibly tough Nelson. It was third and 26 last quarter. Third and 20 now.
But only about 12 yards necessary to be in field goal range. Prukop hit from behind. The ball's out. It is scooped up. Running with it is Brady Aiello. And the guard gets to about the 46-yard line. Well, that's not field goal range. Now it's fourth down.
And Freedom Akinmolodun, the defensive end who has been put on an island at times, as both defensive ends for Mike Riley have tonight, been so burdened by the scheme and the speed, finally has an opportunity to pin his ears back on third and 20 and get home. The leading sacker from a season ago just gets on the edge of the redshirt freshman. No Tyrell Crosby, knocked out of this game with a foot injury, inserted a redshirt freshman in the biggest moment of his life, unable to contain and keep the pocket. And if we have thought it's loud, and my ears are reverberating the way they have for 59 minutes, I can't imagine. And Mike Riley, look at the face. You just know it. This is why he came to Lincoln, Nebraska. He wasn't looking to leave Corvallis. A team that he's matched up, looked across and lost 7 straight times, 10 of 14. Knows that at 4th and 18, he gets a play here, this game's over.
Fourth and 18 to try and extend the game. Nebraska brings a blitz. Prukop is brought down. Michael Rose Ivy all but ends the game for the Huskers.
Five in one possession games last year were the Cornhuskers en route to a 6-7 season. And as much as I despise three-man rushes, which you had on third and 26, sign me up for pressure on fourth and 15. You've had a mindset all game long to get after Dakota Prukop and this Oregon group. You've had a mindset to go for it on fourth down in the first half, outside the book. Fourth and 9 with 4 minutes to go, outside the conventional book. And incredibly aggressive when the game was on the line, when it mattered the most. And I love that mindset.
It is victory formation. Two timeouts left for Oregon, and they can use them should Mark Helfrich choose. But it looks like he's going to call it a day rather than even use his timeouts.
Mark Helfrich
is not even going to force Nebraska to snap the football.
Curious move tonight, at least force two more snaps. They could have run the clock off with three snaps. And how about that guy? What must he be feeling right now? What a game.
It is official. A field goal win for Nebraska over Oregon. And the bath and the hug for Mike Riley as he gets a sweet win against his old nemesis.
Said earlier, these fans remember the past and they so badly want to get back to what they have done. They played a critical role in this game. Their noise, their chaos, this environment played a huge role in this outcome.
Let's go down to Allison.
Coach, first of all, congratulations. What is going through your mind right now?
Oh boy, what a great game. Both teams fought back, you know, it was back and forth. They are really, really proud of our team. Kind of kept our poise. I thought we were really nervous at the start. And so we didn't look like we were very crisp at all, but really, really thought we were tough-minded down the stretch.
What are the emotions you're feeling, though, right now to beat Oregon?
I love it. This for this team right now, this is huge. To beat a good team like Oregon with all the everything that they've done for us at this stage, it is awesome. To be 3-0 going into the Big Ten Conference.
You told us that Oregon is bold, but how did you have to be bold to win this game, specifically going for it on fourth down in the fourth quarter?
Well, I thought that might be the last time we see the ball. And somebody told me that fortune favors the bold. So we had to just leave it out here today. Our kids fought hard all day. We might as well just go for it.
Your quarterback, Tommy Armstrong, requiring an IV there late in the game. What did he show you today?
Yeah, he loves football. He's really tough. He competes like crazy. It's awesome. He played a great football game.
Coach Riley, thank you so much.
Thank you, Alex.
Fortune favors the bold, Brock. They go for it on fourth down and get it. Conversely, two-point conversions hurt Oregon. They missed to the point that they would have had an extra 3 points on the board.
Never felt an environment like this in college football. I sure hope we can do it again. Man, this place was rocking this afternoon.
Terrific win for Nebraska and a terrific effort from the Ducks as well. USC Stanford at 8 on ABC. So long from Lincoln. We head back to the studio.